All right, campers, welcome back. So let's go ahead and look at the graphs of these three inverse trig functions, sine, cosine, and tangent. In case you're wondering, my blue pen was running out of ink, so I just switched to purple. Okay, so inverse sine we already looked at in the previous video. So it looks like that. The x's go from negative 1 to 1. And the y value is negative pi over 2 up to pi over 2. So that was your inverse sine. And the domain for it would be negative 1 to 1. Those are the only numbers you can plug into inverse sine. Nothing lower and nothing higher. All right, inverse cosine. It's like you took this graph and sort of flipped it upside down and shifted it up. So just kind of something like that. And it goes from negative 1 to 1. And on the y values, it goes from 0 all the way up to pi. And then this right here, right in the center, that's the y-intercept. That is right in the middle. So write it pi over 2. And that would be your inverse cosine with the same domain. And the way they came out with this is the same process that they did with inverse sine. They restricted the domain and only looked at a certain section of the graph, and this is how it comes out. Okay, now the third one, inverse tangent. This one is the fun one. Tangent is always the fun function. So its graph does something like that. And it hits the origin. And it resembles an x to, or like the cube root of x. It resembles that graph, but the difference is that this graph, inverse tangent, is stuck in between two horizontal asymptotes. Cube root function doesn't do that. It goes up and down forever. But not inverse tangent. All right, so it has a domain. All reals, negative infinity to infinity. But the range, you know, is just stuck in between here. Well, what on earth is it stuck between? Well, remember, this is inverse tangent. So if we refer back to tangent, tangent had vertical asymptotes, inverse tangent has horizontal. Well, why is that? Well, remember the x and y values flip-flop. So vertical asymptotes become horizontals because they're flipping from x's into y's. So they're going to have those same values, though, and those vertical asymptotes were at pi over 2 and negative pi over 2, so that's where the horizontals are going to sit. Okay. So let's go ahead and look at how to evaluate these trig functions, or kind of the process to go through. So to evaluate them, we need to remember that we are essentially going backwards from regular trig functions. That's what inverse functions do. They just reverse or go backwards from a regular function. So for example, since sine of pi over 4 equals root 2 over 2, then we know that inverse sine of root 2 over 2 equals pi over 4. Since cosine of pi over 3 equals a half, then we know that inverse cosine of a half equals pi over 3. Okay, now there's a little typo in this. That should be, instead of pi over 6, that should be 11 pi over 6. I don't know how I missed the 11, but I did. So since sine of 11 pi over 6 equals a negative half, then inverse sine of negative half is going to equal negative pi over 6. Whoa. Wait a minute. I thought inverse functions just went backwards. Well, they do. Well, why didn't this one go backwards? These two did, but this one didn't. Like, these are two totally different numbers. Well, you have to remember what the range of these inverse trig functions are. So what is the range of inverse sine? because remember when you evaluate the function, all of the answers have to come out into whatever the range is. Well, apparently this 11 pi over 6 is not in the range of inverse sine. Well, look at what we graphed up here. So if your range is going off of your y values, the y values or the output for inverse sine are stuck in between negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. So does, that's obviously a typo as well, 11 pi over 6, this original angle we started with, does that fit in this range over here? Well, that would have to be no, it doesn't. It's way too big, so it does not fit in that range. We want it to, but it just doesn't. So if it doesn't fit into the range, then we have to adjust the answer so it does fit into the range. So this box down here, I kind of wanted to separate like out like the ranges and like what quadrants like you would be drawing your angles on. Because remember when you evaluate a regular trig function, like some of you, you draw the triangles or you go off the unit circle, like you know what quadrant it's in. So that's what I'm talking about, like the quadrant on the unit circle that would, or the triangles that would associate with the actual range of the inverse trig function. So for inverse sine, the range, I said earlier, was negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. So on the unit circle are where you would put the triangles, not the actual graph. We're not talking about this. We're talking about what sections on the unit circle would have actually match up to this. Well, that would be quadrants 1 and quadrant 4. Because negative pi over 2 on the unit circle is down here. And positive pi over 2 is up at the top. So it's rotating, like your angles are rotating in between negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. So any answer that you get for inverse sine has to fall into one of these two quadrants, either 1 or 4, and still be in this range here. So the 11 pi over 6, like it definitely is in quadrant 4, but it's not in the range. So you have to adjust it. Which means you're going to have to rotate like in a different direction to get an answer that fits in the range. And we'll talk about that more in just a second. So let's get the other ones up there. Inverse cosine and inverse tangent. So inverse cosine, if you look at the y values up here, the range would be 0 to pi. So on the unit circle, that would have to fall into quadrants 1 and 2, because 0 would be all the way out here, and pi would be straight out on the left. So you're just rotating from quadrants 1 to 2. And then finally, the third one, inverse tangent, its range is going to be stuck in between the two horizontal asymptotes from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. But you're not actually hitting those values, so you get parentheses. So if you go back to your unit circle, that's also in quadrant 1 and quadrant 4. Because again, it's negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, pi over 2. Just don't include the actual endpoints. Okay, so let's stop the video here. It's kind of like the theory on what we're going to be doing to evaluate these things. And in the next one, we'll start to evaluate.